So last year, I made a video about a bunch of different reptiles that have been discovered in recent years. Every single year, we're discovering more and more new species of animals, especially reptiles and invertebrates, plants, orchids, all sorts of crazy stuff. Now, this last year, 2022, was almost a record year for new discoveries of new species. We discovered over 150 new reptiles and amphibians just last year in the year of 2022. So, today I'm going to tell you about five new reptile species that we discovered in just 1 year alone. To start things off with, ignore the cat, is actually going to be a really cool one. It's a new species of leopard gecko. Now, back in 2017, a leopard gecko was unfortunately found drowned in a water collecting container in a really cool area east of the East Ghats in India. I cannot pronounce the name of it, and I don't want to butcher it and offend anybody, so like all of the Latin names and places, I'm just going to put it right here. Now, as we talked about previously in other videos, there's a bunch of different species in the genus that contains the leopard geckos, and the ones that we have here in the United States and in the pet trade are basically mutts of all the different species and subspecies of them. Now, in this area, there is a species of gecko that already exists, and that's called the East Indian leopard gecko. But last year, 2022, through phylogenetics and morphology, they figured out that this one preserved female, as well as a large population of them out there, are actually genetically separate enough to be considered their own species. And this new species, I'm gonna butcher the name of the leopard geckos, and I know gecko people are gonna just like completely rag on me because I'm incapable of saying this very common genus name, but it's right here. But the new species that belongs to the genus of that contains all the leopard geckos is Pictus. Now that sounds really familiar because we know that there's another already species of gecko called the Pictus gecko. But in Latin, Pictus basically means painted, and that is essentially alluding to the fact that the coloration of the Pictus gecko and now this new species of leopard gecko is somewhat painted in color. Now, they believe that this new species of gecko is fairly common, and there's essentially a river that kind of splits the two species. Although we've also talked about in previous videos how that just because a river splits population doesn't necessarily mean it's enough to actually completely split the animals separated between the two. Fox snakes. But they do think it is fairly common, and they don't necessarily want to classify it as endangered. But according to the several articles that I found about this, that a lot of geckos are killed when they're found. I'm not entirely sure as to why. I know that it's commonplace for people to kill snakes when they find them when they don't understand, but geckos just seems kind of weird. So several people have suggested that they be listed as near threatened, so there is some form of protection on these now new and established species of leopard gecko in the area. This next one is a new species of snake, so obviously I'm excited for it. But not only is it a new species of snake, it's a species of a lapid and a cobra at that. Now, cobras are obviously and easily one of, if not the most recognizable, iconic, and symbolic of all the different snakes in the world, and for fairly good reason. Now, there is one in particular that is definitely the most iconic. The king cobra definitely gets a whole lot of fame, but the picture in most people's minds when they think of a cobra is actually the monocled cobra. It's the one that has the very iconic, really cool hood pattern on the back of their necks, that when it's spread up on the back that looks like those eyes. Now, the monocled cobra is fairly widespread throughout its range throughout central and parts of southern Asia. But there's a lot of variation in them, not only in individuals themselves, but in specific areas, either due to geographic reasons, the prey diversity, the size, the topography of the area, all that. So recent studies have gone through to try to determine whether or not there are actual separate species or subspecies of the monocled cobra. And they found that one in particular, now we're going to designate that as the brown banded cobra, deserves its own full species status. Now, the genus of cobras are called Naja or Naja. Well, however, I do not know the correct pronunciation of it. Please don't get mad at me. So Naja right here. And then this new one is called Fuxi, Fuxi, the, you know, that type of language where the X is the she. So the Naja Fuxi, sorry, is the brown banded cobra. Now, They don't get as large as the king cobras, obviously, and not even as long as, like, say, the forest cobras. They're generally only about 3.5 to 5 feet long and fairly brown in coloration with darker bands that go along its body. Now, a lot of people make fun of taxonomy, including myself, about why do we go through this whole crazy process about trying to distinguish different species versus subspecies and all this stuff. But this is actually a very good example of why it is somewhat important to do this, and that is because a lot of people are bitten every single year in the area where these animals live. The cobras in general, the entire group of snakes called cobras, are responsible for the most bites on people every single year. And it's very important that we can be able to give the correct anti-venom for the different animals to the people when they are bitten to save their lives. And so in this case, if we can go through and determine there is whether or not only a difference in species, but maybe there's a difference in venom, not only in toxicity, but of what actually makes them up, of the different proteins to vary what the actual venom itself does and is very important. So we can't make fun of biologists and taxonomists too much for this. This one is actually a species of amphibian. Now, amphibians I don't talk too much about because I'm more of a snake guy, and so keeping amphibians is a little outside of my wheelhouse of regular care, and so I don't want them ending up getting neglected, as well as most of the people that I interact with in this hobby are more reptile and usually more snake people, so I don't get a whole lot of back and forth with them either, but this one is really cool. This is a new species of clawed salamander found in Japan, specifically on the island of Shikoku. Now, this is a type of lotic breeding salamander, and as far as I can understand it, because it took me a while to try to find an actual definition for the term lotic, but that essentially means, from my understanding, is that it means that they are laying their eggs in moving water versus underground or in still standing shallow puddles or anything like that. And then they continue on with the regular life cycle of salamanders, where the eggs hatch into the nymphs, and then they slowly develop into closer to adult-sized salamanders with gills, and then they eventually go away, and then they move on to a mostly terrestrial life stage as fully adults until the end of their life cycle. Now, these guys are really cool, and I'm going to butcher the name for the genus, so I apologize as always, and I'm going to continue to apologize for that, but the new species name for the salamander is Oni. Now, this is where you would find this habitat is fairly commonplace for what you think of where you would go out and find salamanders. It's forested areas, usually on the slopes of hills, a little bit cooler, lots of vegetation, moss-covered ground. It's very beautiful and iconic. But the specific area where these ones are found is essentially reference to their name. In Japan and in Japanese, Oni essentially refers to a demon or an ogre. And the demon, the Oni demon, lived in the Oni's castle. And the area where the salamander is from is referred to as the Oni castle, or the mountain where the Oni castle was. So it's a really, really cool harken back callback to that. The color may also have something to do with this, in addition to location, because as adults, they're kind of a cool, again, ignore the cat crying. She's really upset, even though I just gave her tension. She still wants tensions. The color is kind of like a reddish brown, almost a purpley color as adults. A really cool species, a new salamander that is very important to biodiversity and for different ecosystems where they live. This next one is really cool. Now, as I mentioned at the beginning of the video, we find new species all the time, mostly of smaller ones. And a lot of the times, it's due to re-looking at under a closer microscope, essentially, of different genetics and mitochondrial differences and through a lot of that kind of fun DNA analysis. But very rarely do we ever figure out that a species is different enough from a very large animal. And that's what this one is. This is not only a large reptile, this is part of the genus that is the largest boas in the world, the anacondas. Now, we've known about this animal for a long, long time. This is the Beni or the Bolivian anaconda. For a very long time, back in 2002 is really when we really first kind of saw them show up on the scene. And for a long time, we actually thought that they might be a hybrid of the green anacondas, the ones that we're all very familiar with, and the yellow anacondas, the ones that are more popular in pet trade because they're more manageable in size. Nyeh. But again, as previously mentioned, through different DNA analysis, under closer look of both not only living animals, but under tissues of preserved specimens, we figured out that the Beni anaconda is its own separate species. Now, it's really easy to think that this animal was in fact a hybrid of the two. they look very close to what a hybrid would look like, where they're smaller than the greens, they're bigger than the yellows, they kind of fit right in between the two, hitting around that, you know, 12 to 14 foot mark, so right in between there. Their spotted coloration is a little bit closer to that of the green anaconda than versus the yellow. The color itself, I should say pattern, the color itself is almost more of like an olive green to brown versus yellow, or the more darker, more vibrant green, if you want to call it vibrant green, of the anacondas, although that can vary a little bit, but it's almost like a greenish brown of the blend of the two, as well as it has more of the head striping of the yellow anaconda, and its behavior was more in line with green anacondas. So in general, it looked like a perfect hybrid of the two. But in fact, it is itself its own distinct species, which is really cool, which brings the total of species of anacondas up to four: the greens, the yellows, the bennies, and the many spotted anacondas. Now, recently, just I believe it was last year, the Benny Anaconda actually made headlines all over the place around the internet. And not for the best of reasons, unfortunately. There was a video that popped up of two South American freshwater river dolphins playing with an anaconda. And that's what it was. It was, in fact, a Benny Anaconda being played with by two male river dolphins. And yes, that distinction is important because they were, in fact, playing with that unfortunate anaconda. Whatever that means is essentially that the Cosbys of the South American river system were essentially using this now deceased anaconda to do their things with, unfortunately. We're going to move away from that to bring us to the last one, but it should be noted that this is already, a lot of people have already seen a picture of this anaconda, more than you've probably realized, but unfortunately not for the best of reasons. The last one on the list is obviously a snake, because I'm Jay-Z, and that's what I like to talk about. And this is the only one on the list that not only if you frequent different Facebook groups and pages that you've probably seen a link for, but the only one on the list that wasn't necessarily defined by phylogenetic or DNA analysis. This is one that we found a new animal in the wild, and then looking at it and then verifying through DNA, we actually discovered this is a new species. This is a new species of dwarf boa in the genus of the Tropidophis, which I've talked about in another video. They're not necessarily considered true boas, but they're still a boaed type snake. It's very complicated and confusing. I go into much more detail. I'll try to remember to put a link for it right here where I talk about it. I believe it was called Five Boas That Aren't Really Boas. Now, these guys are very small. That's why they're considered a dwarf species. The animals that they found in question were less than 7 or 8 inches long, and they estimate that they probably won't get over about a foot long in general. Now, these guys are very interesting. So this was found down in the cloud forests of Ecuador, and they were kind of a reddish-brown coloration, very similar to like the background color of like the boa and piratas that are found in some of those same type of areas, only obviously being much, much smaller. Now, I did my best to try to find out whether or not this is true, but members of the Tropidophis genus, and I kind of butchered that a little bit, have a really interesting thing that they can do, and that is they can actually change color. Now, a lot of reptiles do change color, the most famous of which being chameleons, but a lot of other type of reptiles, including many species of snakes, will actually change colors hormonally, either in different parts of the day, whether they're going into season, whether they're trying to ovulate, different things like that. But the Tropidophis actually change colors throughout the day, where they'll actually be darker during the day to absorb more of that ultraviolet light and heat, and they'll be a more pale color at night to try to avoid that, where they don't need to be as dark, where they don't need to absorb as much light. Now, not every single member of the genus does this, and I couldn't find anywhere in the several articles that talked about them that these guys did in fact do that. However, it's still a really cool new species that is found. It's always exciting when we find new species. It means that we haven't figured everything out in the world. It means that we haven't taken everything out of the world, and it's always very exciting. Hopefully you guys enjoyed today's video. I'm going to do my best to, if you guys have any suggestions, questions, comments, ideas for other videos, let me know down in the comments. I always try to write them down in my new little, I finished my snake notebook. This is my Bigfoot notebook. I always try to write them down. You guys have given me some really good ones over the past few weeks and months, and that's what I'll be doing. Again, thank you so much. If you want to watch the full list the full playlist of the top five or whatever videos right here, or at the very least, you want to go check out other fairly recently discovered types of reptiles, it's in this playlist. Helps my click-through rate, lets YouTube know that I exist and push my content out there. Again, thank you all so much. Hope everyone's having a great day, and we'll check you next time.